हेलो,
हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून अमित प्रशांत सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून। सो आई एम गोइंग टू जॉइन फ्रॉम अनदर डिवाइस एज वेल व्हिच आई विल यूज
ओके
फॉर
सर,
प्रेजेंटेशन।
ओके ओके सर।
Okay.
सर, शैल वी स्टार्ट?
यस, वी कैन स्टार्ट।
ओके, सो गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल ऑफ यू। इट्स माय ऑनर एंड प्रिविलेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस आवर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड स्पीकर डॉक्टर अमित प्रशांत सर। डॉक्टर अमित प्रशांत सर इज द प्रोफेसर ऑफ सिविल इंजीनियरिंग एंड डीन ऑफ रिसर्च एंड डेवलपमेंट एट आई टी गांधीनगर। सर इज करेंटली द चेयरमैन ऑफ अहमदाबाद चैप्टर ऑफ इंडियन जियो टेक्निकल सोसाइटी and also the member of board of governors of SV9T Surat. Sir has completed his bachelor's of engineering degree from IIT Roorkee in 1997, and after 2 years of his consulting experience, he went for higher studies at Clarks University, New York, and then to University of Tennessee, Knoxville. After completing his doctoral studies and 1 year of postdoctoral research, sir has also worked at IIT Kanpur as assistant professor during 2005 to 2010 tenure, and then moved to IIT Gandhinagar in 2010. He also has been actively involved in academic administration as chairman SUGC at IIT Kanpur earlier, and for 6 years as a dean and academic affairs at IIT Gandhinagar. With that experience, sir has also appointed as officiating director of IIT Gandhinagar during July to September 2019. His interest areas are in consecutive modelings of soils, earthquake geotechnical engineering, and application of geosynthetics, which includes experimental investigation and numerical modeling. He has done field projects related to hill slopes, excavation, canals, aesthetics, bridge foundations, barrage, etc. Sir has also conducted several industry courses in earthquake engineering, FEM, and geotechnical investigations, which have been quite popular. He is also coordinating faculty development programs for last 6 years under the aegis of a TIRCIP scheme of Government of India for engineering colleges in country. So, sir, I would like to add here one thing that sir is always welcome open-heartedly the events that is conducted under the aegis of the IGS Ahmedabad chapter. I remember one such event is being conducted in the LDC organized by our department that is RC Sonpa lecture series. And I remember sir not only graced the event with his presence, but also motivated the students to work in the field of geotechnical engineering. And this STTP also is being one of the such example in which sir has been, this IGS student Ahmedabad chapter is approved and sponsored the event also. So thank you sir very much, and without further delay, now I would like to invite Dr. Amit Prashant to share his expertise with all. Over to you sir. Sir, your mic is on mute mode.
Thank you so much for your kind words, and I think it's my pleasure to discuss some of these fundamental topics with the colleagues, and I hope so many of you will find something new in this which you will take home, and also share your experiences with me, which will be useful to me as well. So when we talk about the stability of slopes, whether it is slope in general or embankments that we create, or regarding the landslides, in undergraduate courses, in postgraduate courses, many times we confine ourselves to mainly the analysis methods. And I assume that most of you will know about the equations that you had to deal with, and how to calculate factor of safety and all those things, right? But there is a story behind that. And there is a lot of, you can say, thinking that has to go beyond analysis that we carry out in terms of numbers. And what is that story? That is what the focus of this talk will be, basically. So if I look at a slope, just by looking at it, what can I understand about it? If I go to next step, how am I going to find how it is going to behave, what materials are there, and how, what kind of assumptions I'm taking to perform the analysis? And in the analysis, sometimes, is it sufficient what I have done or not? So those kind of several questions are there. Then there comes that not every slope is same. Some are homogeneous, some are heterogeneous. Heterogeneity can also be of different kinds. So layered profile versus I have rock boulders in between, right? Now, at some place, I have some kind of big mass moving down, and that is a problem. Some places, it's just rock fall that is happening. That's a problem. Now, how do I deal with all that? And some places, it is so slow process that I don't know when it is going to fail, in a way. So there are so many uncertainties, so many unknowns that are there. Now, these things we generally don't discuss in detail in the courses that we have on stability of slopes and embankments, right? So my effort would be to get into some of those aspects. Okay. So let's look at there are two types of slopes that we deal with. One is artificial slopes, or you can say made up slopes, you can say. So when we do construction, we do some cuttings, canals. In cutting, you can say we do this construction of metro rail that is happening in Ahmedabad, right? So you cut it, you make the structure inside, and then fill it back, something like those things, right? And during excavation in building construction, etc. So there are so many cuttings that we do around. And also we have seen embankments, especially for expressways, freight corridors, and we have seen those, that there are embankments being made everywhere, and that can range from 1 meter to sometimes 8-10 meters, right? And it's all hopefully compacted homogeneous soil in a way, but there are other unknowns that may get into that. So whether water is there or not, whether there are other structures coming in interface and so on, so those we have to deal with, besides the stability of the slope in a way. Earth dams. There are more than 500 earth dams in Gujarat itself. We may not know about it, right? From small to medium size in general, right? And a lot of them are in Bhuj area and other areas as well. And of course, they are made so that you can have better water supply, you can have irrigation water, etc., etc. But unique thing about this is that we have water on one side, and on the other side there is no water, right? So that is the difference between highway embankment and earth dams. So temporary excavation, I think in cuttings I have already explained that, and some heaps of mining, you can say materials, or during construction, if I have to excavate too much, I have to pile it up. All those, whether they are stable or not, they're fresh fills, and they can sustain over time. Besides that, there can be piranhas also. So those are like biodegradable, partly some materials that we dump as a hill, and it becomes a big mountain over time. And whether they are stable or not, and if they interact with water during rains, how they are going to behave, whether it is life threatening or it is okay to leave it like that, it may fail, but I don't care if it is not life threatening in a way. So those kind of estimates we need for those aspects as well. Then the second part is whatever natural slopes are there. So whenever I go to Udaipur, I go through this highway, serpentine roads, cutting through this small mountains. But fortunately, these mountains are relatively stable, right? We don't see much of landslides or much of failures on the way. But if we go to Konkan Railway, there is a lot of story that you will find on Google, that there are so many failures, and there are still some failures, but we save our trains from that. Right? And how do we save it? What kind of measures that were taken? Some of those measures you may have seen a couple of days back from Minimal. She had presented, I think, some case studies on that, right? So there are several such aspects that we can look into briefly. And then you have coastal region, river cliffs, etc., which can be really vertical, you can say rocky type formations. And in coastal region, you can have high water table situations and so on. So they have different dynamics. I mean, sometimes even 5-10 degree of slope can be dangerous. Sometimes it can move down, and especially during earthquake conditions, right? And river cliffs, they appear to be very cliffs. They can collapse with the you can say any disturbance or any water ingression and those kind of situations. But many of those formations are there for ages, and they're stable as well. Now, how do I know whether it is going to be stable or I should worry about it, and so on? Now, any of these failures have secondary effects as well. So, for instance, imagine if I have a dam, and behind that I have a catchment area, right? And there are 3 or 4 mountains that are confining that catchment area on the sides. Now, one of those mountains fails, right? And all the soil or rock or whatever it is, it comes down to the catchment area. Now, what will happen in the water? It will create a big ripple, and that ripple can actually damage the dam also. And if it goes over, then that goes to the down the slope, and that water becomes unmanageable, more or less, right? So there are several issues of such sort we need to think about. Okay, so let's look at a little bit summarizing some of those types of slopes. So natural slopes can be sometimes with existing slip surfaces also, or without that slip surface, you can say, sometimes. So when the disturbance happens in the natural slopes with time, and if a certain amount of mass is trying to move down slowly, right? Now, there will be some point where it is, you can say, differentiating from rest of the mass below, right? And at that interface, you are forming a slip surface in a way. Now, what happens to the soil at that slip surface? Imagine that. Now, that soil, if it is not clay, even if it is some other soil, every soil particle has some kind of angularity, some kind of you can say aspect ratio, and so on. Now, as the deformation happens, these particles try to align themselves along the slip surface, and the friction angle that, or the properties that you had estimated otherwise, may not be applicable there. And the density of the soil at that interface at the slip surface may also change. Now, how are you going to account for that? There's a very simple answer. So we do residual shear strength type testing, ring shear apparatus can be used, something like those things, right? But the properties are different and we have to know. Now, these slopes like creep with time. And how do I know whether they are going to be stable? How do I monitor that as well? So those kind of issues are there, several management issues as well. Then when we are designing engineering slopes for highways, earth dams, levees, riverbank protection work, river training work, you can say as well, cut slopes with the natural soil being in the back, not really fill soils, and slopes with the retaining structures we provide for stability, and landfills, as I mentioned. So there are several variety of problems that we deal with when we are talking about slopes. Some photographs for entertainment or just to get a sense, you can say. Mm-hmm. So embankment dams can be there, temporary construction slopes. These are like mine dumps, kind of waste material dump kind of things, or hillside valleys. You have huge slopes, and this is river cliff that I was talking about earlier. So these can be really huge sometimes. Now, let's look at some of the failures. If I have an embankment, right? If something happens in terms of some conditions changing due to rains, or rain is the very biggest contributor in some sense, but other than that, something has happened in the ground at the foundation level, or you can say some disturbance has happened in the slope soil itself. So for instance, it's a dispersive soil, there is some water ingression that is happening, and some of the soil got eroded with time, right? So all kind of disturbances are happening in the soil even after 10 years, 20 years, 30 years sometimes, right? Now, those disturbances, how do they impact the embankment is one thing, but eventually if it cannot sustain, it will fail. And some of the failure, you can say weird type failures are shown here. In terms of different cases. Oh, sorry. What happened? Yeah. This is a very good example of probably there is some superpower above us exists, and that saved thousands, so millions of life rather, right? This is San Fernando Dam. Now, it was supposed to be like this. And when the earthquake hit, some of that slope is gone, right? And only this much is remaining. And this is the sun condition here. Now, just imagine if this part had also washed away. If this guy here had just collapsed, that's it. Now, what would have happened? This water will start moving out in this, and this whole soil on the slope will start eroding. And once that process starts, who can stop it? Nobody can stop it. And imagine the amount of water that is being stored in the back and how far it will go. It can go hundreds of miles of flooding, you can say, and it can wipe off cities altogether, you can say, right? And there were cities a couple of hundred miles away from this dam. In a way, and that those could have been affected hugely in a way, but just saved, you can say, from that. So it is important to worry about whether slopes are stable. We all know that, but is the analysis sufficient, or we need to worry about many other things as well, right? So in a way, we'll discuss some of those aspects on the way. Well, what are the forces that we need to worry about? So, of course, gravity is one of the most important contributor to the slope stability, yes, right? Then you have seepage conditions or water tables or poor water pressure building up because of that. Because we know the strength actually is governed by effective stress. So whatever load is coming at some point, we convert that into a pressure, you can say, total pressure, and then we subtract pore pressure from that, and then we get effective stress. And whatever effective normal stress that we expect at a point, that will govern how much shear strength I'm going to have, right? So pore pressure becomes important. So even if the slope is same, everything is same, if pore pressure changes because of some reason, your strength is going to go down and you are going to have issues of deformations or failure, right? So normal effective stress along interface becomes very, very important, and that is dictating the shear stress that is developing, as well as what is shear strength that is going to be there. How pore pressure or can contribute to shear stress development? Pore pressure is developing because there is some water increase, right? If water is increasing, the density is increasing, overall density or unit weight of the soil, and that is going to cause increase in the shear stress as well on the slope. Okay, so what are the major causes of failure? Slope fails because of inertial loading. You can say gravity is one of those, right? Increase in shear stress because of some reason, the mass is increasing, or you can say some kind of pore pressure is increasing because of that. So whatever effective weight that is involved, that is changing. Or it can be material is losing its shear strength, or it may lose to even liquefaction level at some point, not everywhere, of course. So if along the slip surface where I'm going to have stability from, at any point, if strength is lost, the overall strength is going down. So there is a decrease in shear strength overall, right? So ultimately, the capacity that is available to sustain the slope is going down, right? There can be some other causes as well. So there is a crest settlement of dam, as I showed for the San Fernando Dam, right? So due to earthquake, there is a settlement of because of failure in that case, actually, slope failure inside, you can say, or upstream side, right? But there can be several reasons, floods, earthquake induced, all those things can cause water topping over the embankment, and that is causing a crest to either erode or settle in a way, and both are dangerous, right? Then foundation soil is deforming below the embankment or below the dam. That can cause some problems, right? So there can be other issues also, like piping, erosion of soil locally or on the surface or inside sometimes, right? So for example, if you use dispersive soils like even micaceous silt, micaceous sand, those are like very loose soils to, you can say, react to water and wash away. So those kind of things can cause problems in a way as well. And if you have earthquake faults, they can also cause, of course, failures, and rarely we check that. So there is some research that we are doing at IIT Gandhinagar also on this part, in a way, how fault movements can impact. And you know, Gujarat is full of different faults, fault lines. Even if you go from Ahmedabad to Mumbai, on the way you will find at least 3 or 4 significant faults on the way, although they have not activated for some time, right? Okay, so we said there are two reasons. One is increase in shear stress, and second was decrease in shear strength, right? So what are the things that cause increase in shear stress? Erosion or excavation at the bottom of the slope. Now that can increase shear stress. How? How can that increase shear stress? Erosion or excavation that I'm doing at the bottom of the slope, right? So mass is same, right? But the supporting area is less now. Because of that, what will happen? The length or the area that is involved is lower, and mass or weight is same. So weight divided by area is going to be your stress. So that stress is increasing, right? A sudden drop in water level or drawdown of water bodies, right? That can cause seepage downwards, and so soil is saturated and the water support on the side is gone, you can say. So overall weight on the slip surface is going to increase because of that. And then you have shear stress increase you have to calculate for, right? Overloading at the top of slope. We can have a tank moving on the expressway, or we can, during construction, we dump 5 meters of soil above. You may laugh at it. Why would somebody do that, right? But actually, if you go around, you will find many cases, such cases. So I can give you one example, very simple example of that, right? So there was a canal that was being built about, maybe I can tell you the state, it was in Maharashtra, not here. So when you make a canal, you have in cutting as well as in embankment sometimes, right? So when you make in cutting, the soil is being excavated and that is supposed to be dumped far away, right? Not near the slope itself. But what they did is 2 or 3 meters of soil, they dumped it at the top, which it was not designed for, right? It was designed for the final level of the, at the ground level, you can say, right? But now you have 2-3 meters of soil above that level. So slope length has increased. If slope length has increased, soil is more, mass is more, your stresses are going to be more. And that caused a lot of distress and some failures as well. Over time, not immediately. It happened over 4 or 5 years that it got failures in a way. So that is another interesting thing. Many of these things, the influence you will see after a few years, not necessarily immediately, right? When you have worst case scenarios or near worst case scenarios developing with time, right? Then we have water pressure from crack or fissures. And when you studied this topic in undergrad, you remember in retaining wall earth pressure calculations, especially, you had tension cracks. If they get filled with water, you have huge pressure coming on the mass as a water pressure itself. And that can cause increase in earth pressure. Similar kind of situation you can imagine here as well. So your length of support is reduced. So overall length where resistance of the mass is available, that area has decreased. And water pressure at the top is causing horizontal force on the embankment, or you can say mass on the slope side, and that is further increasing the stress in a way. Beyond that, you have freezing or freeze-thaw kind of conditions, and that can also create pressure and add to shear stress. Slopes absorbing water from rainfall is one of the major cause of failures many times, right? So if we have accounted for certain seepage conditions in the slope design, or there is a natural slope where there was a stable seepage and we accounted for that, but over the next 10 years, somehow the water table or seepage lines have increased, you can say, have gone up, you can say, right? Because of more rainfall, or for some weird reason, the water retention is more. So you can say some disturbances on the slope surface, and that has caused increase in water absorption or water retention on the embankment, or on the mountain, or on the some hillock, you can say, right? Because of that, the pore pressure is going to increase, and that is going to decrease the effective stress, effective confinement, and shear stress is going to eventually increase in a way. The density is going to increase as well, right? So unit mass is changing, bulk density is becoming saturated density at many places. Then because of that, the overall mass that is contributing to shear stress is increasing. Then other than that, of course, you have transitory loading or transition loading, you can say, for short term, like earthquakes. You can have tsunamis as well. Okay, then second category we said is decrease in shear strength. What and where this decrease happens. So you can have weathering, physicochemical activities happening over time, and that can reduce the friction angle or cohesion of the soil with time, right? Decomposition of rocks, boulders due to wetting, drying process, similar kind of phenomena as weathering, that you will see reduction in cohesion or friction angle with time. Structural degradation due to cyclic loading. As I mentioned about this landslides, how they develop a slip surface, and along the slip surface, they are creeping down. And with the creeping down, you have particles orienting themselves in certain way that the strength reduces. Similar kind of situation you can imagine with large man-made embankments as well. but at a local level. Like, for example, if you have traffic, heavy traffic, you know, subgrade and the stresses that are below, they can also have some plastic deformation sometimes, especially if we have heavy loading once in a while kind of thing, right? And that reduces the life of the embankment in a way. But that is still manageable. Earthquake is the biggest problem. Hydrodynamic forces are a bigger problem. So if they are strong, you can have, you can say, distress buildup in the embankments, even if it has not failed. So what that distress will do, it will have some plastic deformations, and if plastic deformation is large enough, it would have caused similar kind of phenomena what we saw in landslides, right? And that will cause reduction in strength. With the, every cycle of loading, we will have more and more reduction in a way, right? And that kind of behavior you will see when you do dynamic triaxial test or something, you will see stiffness degradation at the same magnitude of loading with number of cycles, right? So similar kind of thing you will have in those embankments as well. Creep effects, I just explained briefly to you, with sustained shear loading, with time you have some movement happening, as if the slope is at critical stability level. So factor of safety is close to one, you can say, right? And the seasonal variations induce, you can say, disturbances, and due to increase in water or some other reasons, you can say, and factor of safety maybe in summer will be high, and then in rainy season or post-rain rains, factor of safety has come down, that kind of thing, right? So that way it keeps on deforming with time, and you have sudden failures sometimes. Cracking in cohesive soils, that can be seen more in expansive type soils, even more, but otherwise also clays are prone to, you can say, cracking when they are dry, because they have shrinkage, right? There is a shrinkage limit, which is lower than the plastic limit, you can say, right? So as the moisture variation happens, you can have, you can say, shrinkage of the material, and that can cause cracks. Now, one weird question I can ask, that fair enough, it will have cracking. If I have rains, if water goes through cracks, how much time it will take for material to get saturated and apply the saturated weight on the slope, right? So permeability of clay is supposed to be 10 to the power minus 8 minus 9 centimeter per second kind of thing, right? Which means even 1 centimeter movement of water should take maybe a couple of years. But I don't see that happening in the field. When I go to the field, if you go to Dholera area, let's say, right, if you go in May end, you will see that a lot of cracks, very hard strata, and you can run, walk, have your bike run on the ground just like that, and so on, right? And if you go just May end, what happens? Just after first rain, right, or second rain, you can say, right? What happens? You can't even walk there. And that is a top soil is clay kind of thing, right? Now, how that water got absorbed so fast? That's a question that should come, right? So the answer is here itself. So cracks visible to you are large, but then you have trees of cracks. So large one you see, then they will be bifurcated into smaller ones, and further small, further small, further small. So even it goes to the micro cracking level, right? And the water is going to every nook and corner of the soil through these cracks, and they don't have to travel actually even 1 centimeter to saturate it even. So even a couple of millimeters going to, you can say, find a crack somewhere, which may not be visible to your eyes, you can say, right? So that network takes care of the saturation so fast, you can say, many times. So if you take soil in the lab and just put a water, it will not go in so easily. Especially if it has some saturation level already and it doesn't have crack, right? But if it is dry, actually it can have more, much faster crack, saturation. Another aspect that contributes to that is suction. you can say, right? So little bit of moisture and you have suction condition. The moment you add water to it, it has huge suction pressure acting on that to pull the water in, you can say. So that can also happen. Changes in void ratio in swelling clays. If void ratio changes or increases, you see that suction is reducing and void ratio is increasing, and all those things are going to contribute to reduction in cohesion or cohesive strength, and that is decrease in shear strength, right? Effective stress due to pressure buildup that we talked about, it can happen due to earthquake or seepage condition changes as well, right? Vibrations, especially in sensitive clays. So if you go to, let's say, Adani Port area or something like those kind of areas where Bhavnagar area, you can say, where you have very sensitive type clays, marine clays. And if you go to south, you can say south of Surat and especially Bombay area, some of those reclaimed lands, reclaimed areas, the soil can be really sensitive, right? So if you create a little bit of disturbance, the soil structure loses its intactness in a way, and the particles start behaving like they want to run away from each other. And then you have strength loss completely. And imagine what earthquake can do there, right? Erosion of dispersive soils. So I can give you an example of that. And there are several such examples. So there was a thermal power plant in UP area that I visited about 10 years back, right? So that they have this ash dikes, right? And these ash dikes are like earth embankments in the first raising, the ground up first embankment. And inside that, they create a lagoon where they dump fly ash, right? Or bottom ash or pond ash sometimes actually it's called, right? Mix of both bottom ash and fly ash, right? So that is dumped in a slurry form. So it has a lot of water and so on seepage through the earth embankment that is making the lagoon and so on. But rains are also happening. And unfortunately, they used local soil without realizing that it's a dispersive soil, right? So when we were walking and there was a distress, you can say, in the embankment. So they called me to look at it. And then we went there, and when you look at the surface, you will see that it's a nice embankment, nothing is wrong, but a small hole is there, right, somewhere. And they were worried that hole is going to cause damage or something. When we went there, we said, okay, just take a small hammer and just tap on it, on the sides of the hole. You have 1 to 2 meters of size of soil from the surface just collapsed. And what we saw is huge cavity inside. Now imagine it was just sustaining somehow. I don't know how, but it can collapse anytime because it has lost almost half of the embankment, in a way, right? Now these kind of cavities can form internally. That's what I wanted to tell you. And you will not see them from outside. And these kind of problems are there in many of the dams nowadays. And that's where you see there is a big mission that is being run nowadays. Mainly the Water Resource Department is coordinating that to check the health of the embankments or rather dams and rehabilitate them. And this is one of the problems that they have to deal with, right? Progressive failure due to strain softening of soil mass. I have explained that, like the landslide issues kind of thing, right? Specifically to dams, we have overtopping due to erosion of the material at the top or progressive failure of the slope, and that can cause overtopping of water. And once the water starts flowing from the top, it will only increase the problem, and then probably the whole dam can fail in a way. Piping on the downstream side, that can weaken the soil, and this seepage water can be controlled through some relief wells or some drainage systems and so on. Water is the biggest challenge of geotechnical engineering. Water is life, but at the same time for geotechnical structures, that's the biggest threat in a way. And don't try to contain it, rather train it, I would say. So it's better to train water out keep it away, move it away, deflect it, you can say, rather than stopping it in a way. So that is how things work. So same way for piping also, you relieve the pressure somehow so that it doesn't affect your structure. Sometimes even filters are provided for that purpose so that it, water can ease out relatively easily without causing any damage, right? Then you can have structural failures as well. So slopes can fail, of course, and the cracking, deformation, settlements in foundations, otherwise that can happen. And those we have to check. We do check anyway. So these are common things that we all know about, right? So for the specific to dams, slide is not moving somehow. Is supposed to move. You are able to hear me, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So somehow slide is not. Now it's changing. Very good. So okay, preventive measures for against dam especially, and we'll come to landslides also later, which is different problem altogether. So we can provide additional dam height. We can provide measures to minimize erosion. We can like as simple as some kind of grass development on that, or pitching, or you can say some kind of jute interventions. We can do something like those things, which helps water to drain out but not take soil with it, kind of thing. On the downstream side, you can provide some filters and etc. that will help in against piping, etc. You have to provide actually, right? This one is talking about filter sections actually. So you avoid cracking if it can happen in the core, kind of things. Use of sub-rounded gravel or sand as a filter material. Rather, you can just say use good filter materials. Near vertical chimney drains in the center portion, many times they are provided. So opposite core. So core is made of, usually we call it impermeable materials, right, in the dams. So that seepage is less. Or I can do the other way around. I can provide sand chimney in the center where all the water that is coming from upstream side can collect in that, and drainage is so fast that downstream side will not be affected. And all the water from the chimney will be taken out safely from the bottom of the embankment, you can say bottom of the dam. And that is usually the design we do for ash dikes especially, right? So we don't use clay core in ash dike design in a way. So that's alternative way of handling the downstream side issues. But of course, upstream side issues will remain the way they are. So we have to worry about them. Zoning of the section to minimize saturation of material as much as possible. Uniformly graded filter materials, self-healing if cracking occurs, that will help. Rim slopes on the catchment area that I was talking about, right? So you don't worry about only the dam and the catchment, the mountains and hills or the valley that you are using, the slopes of those valley have to be stable as well. So we should worry about that rim area of the catchment, you can say, or the reservoir, sorry, I should not say catchment, I should say reservoir area. So that rim valley area has to be stabilized as well. We can use ground improvement if we see liquefaction issues. Ground improvement can be as simple as, and especially subject to liquefaction issues, not strength issues, really. So it can be as simple as sand drains or relief wells or those kind of things, which can, you can say, move out the water without liquefaction being, you can say, induced in that area. Or we can densify by compaction. That can also help, right? Piping, we provide, again, similar solutions of reducing the seepage to a lower level, not to the surface, by providing filters or relief wells. Okay. Okay, so somehow reaction is very slow. I'm yet to see next slide. Yeah, okay. So when we go for a site, what are the things we should look at? Of course, topographic conditions, geology that I should look at, foundation soil, how it is and so on, bedrock, how far it is from the surface, and where is the borrow area to make that embankment or the dam. And that borrow area soil is very important, especially against certain weird behavior like dispersivity. So all those properties, grain characteristics, how plasticity is varying, shear strength values, all those things we will check for design purpose anyway. But dispersivity is, we can't really control it. So better treat it or avoid it, right? And then we have in situ testing for, you can say, measuring the properties after compaction, if it is embankment, or before, you can say, for natural slopes, we can do investigation on that by standard penetration test and so on, and find seepage conditions with piece of, some kind of, you can say, those tubes that we install on that, right? So what do you call them? Some kind of piezometers, right? Piezometers kind of thing, right? And for soft clays, etc., we use field bend shear test instead of SPT. SPT is not good for clays, we know that, right? And we can also do geophysical methods to confirm the results or find certain properties like how much is the wave velocity and how that can be used in earthquake seismic design as well. There are certain studies that are needed for earthquake perspective. Those are usually done by the seismologist, and we should rather trust them to find out what is the applicable ground motion for our design, or you can say maximum acceleration that I should use for design. Okay, stability, we need to worry about it at different phases of construction as well as at long term. So during construction, we call that as short term. Long term is way after the construction. And in the long life of embankments, you can have changes in the surrounding, and surroundings can impact the slope as well, right? So any secondary effect coming onto the slope, that has to be, you can say, accounted for either at the time of construction of the slope, or any changes that we see with time, we can check it back again, whether it is, if the slope will be still safe with those modifications or not, kind of thing, right? Then you have rapid drawdown. So flood happened, and after that water is going down, and then you have embankments or levees saturated, and then suddenly water table going down is going to have impact on the stability of the slope. Natural disturbances, flooding, heavy precipitations absorbing into the embankment, you can say, accumulation of some more material at the top for some reasons, and earthquakes, of course, right? Okay, I hope next slide comes. Let's wait for that. Okay, while it is trying to come, I will say, we talked about short-term analysis and long-term analysis. And we also know something called undrained strength and drained strength, right? Third thing we were taught in undergraduate itself is something called total stress analysis and effective stress analysis. Now, these three pairs were there in a way. So let's understand what is total stress analysis and what is effective stress analysis. Just recall that, right? So if testing has been done in such a way that pore pressure was not measured or not known, any of those, right? So in that case, pore pressure is out of equation. We don't know anything about it. What we can measure for externally is the load that we are applying, and we can convert that into stress at the most. So from that kind of condition, what I'm going to get is total stress strength parameters, right? So the parameters are going to be based on total stress. So like unconfined compression test or unconsolidated undrained test, UU test, or if I do CU test for some weird reason, I don't measure pore pressure, it will give me the same thing in a way, right? So in a way, if pore pressure is existing there and we don't know about, then we are dependent on only total stress parameters. And that is where, if total stress parameters are available, I can perform only total stress analysis in a way, right? I cannot perform effective stress analysis, right? But if, let's say, pore pressure is zero throughout, we don't need to measure, then we know pore pressure, then it can be effective stress analysis, right? So if you have undrained condition in the ground, relatively fast loading or low permeability material in the ground, especially clays, then another problem comes there is with that slope, whatever you can say loading happened due to earthquake or gravity loading itself, whatever changes are happening there during construction, how pore pressure is changing in the ground, if we don't know, then what information we have about the slope? We have only total stresses available again, right? So even if I have from the laboratory data available to me effective stress parameters, but in the field, I know only total stress values, right? Then effective stress parameters are useless for me. I can perform only total stress analysis. So I better have total stress parameters to perform the total stress analysis, right? Similarly, if I go to effective stress, it's a vice versa situation. So if I perform direct shear test, which is done on granular soils, avoided on clay soils, and we know that granular soils are freely draining, relatively freely draining non-cohesive materials. And as this loading is done in direct shear, it is expected that the water pressure will not build up at the failure slip surface. So it remains as a drained test. It's a direct shear remains as a drained test. So that means pore pressure is assumed to be zero at the failure slip surface. So if it is assumed to be zero, then pore pressure is known in a way. So whatever total stress we are applying, normal stress at the top, that is same as effective stress. So we have effective stress parameters coming from direct shear test. Similarly, with consolidated undrained test or consolidated drain test, CU test or CD test, CD test, no problem because pore pressure is zero throughout. It's a drain test. CU test, if we measure pore pressure, then we know effective stress at any point. So we can determine the effective stress parameters. So that is the story from the parameter side. Wherever I can establish effective stresses at different points of the test, and I'm using those effective stress values to determine my failure stress, failure shear strength or shear strength, corresponding to that, then we call it effective stress parameters. Now, similarly, in the field also, I should know what is the pore pressure, or if it is long-term analysis or with granular material where the water dissipation or pore pressure dissipation happens fast, you can say water drains out fast. So in that case, I can assume the pore pressure is zero, or you can say excess pore pressure is zero. So whatever steady state pore pressure may be there, that we know from the water table, right? So that way, if I know the water pressure that is existing in the field and we have effective stress parameters from the lab, then I can perform the effective stress analysis. So this kind of understanding we have now, and I'm just revising from what you studied in undergrad or postgraduate courses earlier, in a way, right? So just to summarize, in a way, stability analysis can be done in two stages. One is immediately after construction or during construction, you can say, which is, you can say, not going to have pore pressure if it is sandy material, right? Because it drains fast. So you can use effective stress parameters. And if pore pressure didn't exist even at the end of construction, I mean, it will be same situation after long term as well. So effective stress parameters will be used there as well. If you have cohesive soil, then it makes a difference in a way. So at the end of construction or immediately after construction or during construction as well, pore pressure is building up there, right? And it is not going to dissipate in a couple of months. It may take years for pore pressure to dissipate, right? So in that case, that short-term analysis or immediately after construction analysis or end of construction analysis will be undrained analysis. Undrained parameters have to be used, right? Now, that can be total stress or effective stress analysis, depending on what parameters you have and depending on what pore pressure information you have for the site. So usually one of those is missing, so you end up with total stress analysis in cohesive soils, right, for the end of construction analysis. And for long-term analysis, you do effective stress parameters, there is no other option, right? Now, total stress is not reality, effective stress is reality, we know that, right? So if I don't get representative sample without disturbance and we don't perform the test immediately after recovering the samples, immediately means in a couple of days, maybe maximum a week, by protecting its moisture and so on, a lot of care has to go in there. Then I can replicate whatever happened was in the site and in the lab is same in a way, right? And that way I can say it is a representative strength, then I can use that. So if I see effective stress is a generic property, effective stress parameters give generic properties, and total stress parameters are going to be dependent on what is the condition in the field of, you can say, pore pressure and how it is going to sustain those, you can say, effective stress, which is unknown. And it is going to be affected by any other parameter that is affecting effective stress as well, right? So besides that, in a way. So total stress analysis has to be done with all due care because of that. As representative testing as possible, first we do that, and then we perform the analysis, right? Okay. Then, so during construction or immediately after construction, we generally perform drained analysis for coarse grained soils or granular soils, you can say, and undrained analysis for fine grained soils. Now, fine grained soils can have total stress analysis or effective stress analysis, depending on what is known for the from the field and what is known from the lab test, in a way. So if any of those are not known to the effective stress level, then we have to perform total stress analysis, right? Otherwise, if effective stress parameters are available, effective stress is known in the field, no problem, you can perform effective stress analysis with undrained condition. Long-term analysis, however, will be drained with a steady state pore pressure due to water table accounted for, you can say, as well. And effective stress parameters have to be used. And the challenge would be for clay soil, what is the effective stress parameter? Because most of the projects you don't perform CU test or CD test where you can know effective stress. Most of the time you end up with unconfined compression test, or maximum somebody will do unconsolidated undrained test, and those give total stress parameter. So long-term analysis cannot be performed unless you have effective stress parameters. We have to remember that. So you cannot use total stress parameters for long-term analysis, period, right? Okay. Residual shear strength, I'll come to, yeah, next slide. So for especially for creeping type slopes or landslide kind of slow landslide development type that happens over years, those kind of slopes, you can say, we have those, the phenomena that I explained to you in the beginning, that the shear strength is reducing. And if I do a very good triaxial test or direct shear test, even then it is difficult to reach to the deformations or the level of deformations that we are talking about in that. So those creeping type slip surface deformations can be very, very large, like 40%, 50%, 100% strain kind of things, right? So in that case, sometimes people did in the past some reversible type direct shear test, but that doesn't represent that behavior as well. Another test that was developed later was ring shear apparatus. So where you take two, you can say, rings and fill with soil and then rotate continuously in one direction. So with large deformations, you get some shear strength as the residual shear strength, and that you use for the stability analysis for such creeping type conditions, right? But many times those kind of tests are not possible, right? And that's where some people have recommended some or codal provisions are there to reduce the strength as it to 80% or maybe more sometimes, or some correlations are given depending on the soil type, right? So those kind of help are available if data is not available, right? So we can have piezometers and those kind of things if we want to know pore pressure distribution in the field for a certain problem. So it is possible to know what is the pore pressure at present, but during construction also we can measure maybe, but before doing all those things, how would I know? Well, you can't know, right? So, but measurements are possible and we can verify results from time to time, whether it is still stable or I need to do some interventions. Okay. Certain drawdown condition. I hope it works. Yeah. So you have, you see, okay, I think it's slow. Let it go to the next slide. So I have time up to 3:30, right? 15-20
yes,
minutes?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So I'll wrap it up in 15-20 minutes. Okay. Yeah. So sudden drawdown I was talking about. So you have this kind of situation where it is going down and you see the water has now started flowing in the direction of arrows, blue arrows that you see. And that's where the you can say the seepage direction is changing. And that can damage the surface by seepage as well. And the pore pressure is going to change its way of its values at different points. And now imagine how that is going to change the slip surface and its stability, right? So that has to be accounted for in some way. Classically, we have been using limit equilibrium methods for slope stability analysis, right? We assume certain failure surface and along that we find stability, factor of safety based on assumption of that moving mass is rigid, right? And it is failing only at the slip surface. We all know that, right? If the factor of safety is equal to 1, then we say the slope is failing or about to fail. If it is less than, it has failed, of course. Acceleration will be there. If it is more than 1, it is not failing. But then for unknowns that are there in loading as well as parameter estimations, etc., you would like factor of safety to be much more than 1, right? So that's where different codes recommend different critical values of factor of safety, and that we have to account for, right? Now, factor of safety also I can define in different ways, you can say. But in nutshell, we say that capacity over demand is my, or supply over demand is my factor of safety. So resistance available in terms of shear stress, in terms of moment, whichever criteria you choose, you say how much is available versus what is the mobilized force, and that ratio is your factor of safety, right? We can define that as shear strength divided by Fs is the maximum shear stress that you can apply. Fs is your factor of safety, right? In slope stability analysis, generally we have been using Moore-Coulomb model for limit equilibrium analysis because it's simple, right? Simple rigid plastic model, material model, we call, there is no elasticity involved in this. There is no deformation involved in this. Only strength is involved, right? So C5 parameters with which form Moore-Coulomb failure criteria with rigid plasticity, right? Within that, we can have effective stress analysis or total stress analysis. Of course, we all know about C prime, phi prime, we use for effective stresses whenever we use prime. And when we don't use prime, we use symbol as total stress, right? Okay, now one assumption in many of the methods that you would need to take would be the factor of safety with respect to cohesion and factor of safety with respect to friction angle has to be same, right? So if I'm using FS, that FS should be factor of safety against both in a way, independently also. And if you have gone through the methods, you will realize that how important this assumption is, because many times we assume one factor of safety for C and then find out at what factor of safety, at what mobilized friction I will get the same factor of safety for a given slope, you can say something like that, right? So in general, if you have more uncertainty, you will go to larger factor of safety. For more important structures, you will go for larger factor of safety. And most of the time, for at least typical structures, odor provisions would be enough for you to decide that. But special structures, you need to worry about it yourself. I'm just listing down the type of analysis that you can do, but I'm not going to talk about analysis methods here. So you know about infinite slopes. You know about finite slope analysis. Within finite slope analysis, you have those ordinary method of slices and simplified Bishop's method. And before that, you had mass movement methods, kind of Swedish circle, friction circle methods. I'm sure all of you have done most of those methods. There are several more methods that you will see in life, but they are similar in nature. Analysis is similar. Some assumption, one or two here and there, may vary. And because of that, that has got different name. And of course, with those different assumptions, it is applicable to certain conditions in some cases where other method may not be applicable, right? So those kind of situations can be there. Like, for example, if you have planar weak plane, weak planes somehow in the immediate slope, simplified Bishop method may not work because it assumes circular slip surface, right? So then you may need Janboos method or something like that to take care of that nonlinear surface like this. On the next slide, you will see, right? So weak stratum is there in some form. Then it is difficult for you to do it using the classical methods. Generally, if you have low cohesion or granular materials, right, then the curvature of the slip surface is less marked, you can say. It's more of a planar surface, relatively. If you have inhomogeneous materials, then you see more of a, you can say, nonlinear type, highly nonlinear type surface. Well, there are some contradictions in that. Sometimes people say homogeneous homogeneous clay type deposits, they give you circular slip surface. And sandy type deposit, homogeneous even, they give you log spiral type surface and so on. So there are some variations in that. I just wanted to flag this to you that different methods are available because different assumptions have to be taken sometimes for the type of failure that you would assume in the slope. Okay, so when I have to do analysis, there are several good softwares that are available now. Nowadays, I don't need to do perform analysis by hand, but you should do at least once in life so that, and you have done in the past, I'm sure. So then you don't need to worry. Now you can follow certain softwares which can do analysis for you. Don't trust software blindly. Do check for simple cases or have some sanity check on the analysis that you have done. And there is a reason behind that, because manually it is now almost impossible to do analysis for weird shape of the slopes, for various scenarios that evolve within the slope and so on, right? So how many analysis you will do if you don't use computers, right? So that's where the challenge is. And I'll explain on the next slide how the challenging it can be, right? So if you look at a slope, it may have some, you can say, layered formation. There can be soil A, soil B, soil C, different layers of soils in the strata. Then you can have water conditions which are different, which are varying. On the left side, what you see is simply a water body. On the right side, you see seepage water, nonlinear curve as a ferritic line. And then you may have some surcharge loads due to traffic, due to building, foundations, whatever it may happen at the top of the slope kind of thing, right? So those kind of loadings that you have to define first. But there can be several load cases also. So for each load case, what we have to do, that is what we are going to discuss briefly, right? Now, I know the method, how to find factor of safety for a given slip surface. But that slip surface may not be critical. So how do I find that? Now, there are several optimization techniques that are used in different softwares. And one of the classical method was to, let's say, take a small zone of by you can say some kind of heuristic or experience, you can say some grid pattern for the center of the circle or focus of the log spiral or something like those things. So we decide some kind of you can say way of varying the slip surface. There can be other ways as well, right? We can say that there is a zone at the top and there is a zone at the bottom, and all the slip surfaces will go from the top zone to bottom zone in different radiuses, right? So there are several radiuses, I assume. So in a way, what we are trying to do is create so many slip surfaces and analyze factor of safety for that, right? By due consideration to the loading variations, whether there are expected to be cracks, if there is a seepage variation, etc., all those things have to vary as well, right? So just imagine how many times you have to do analysis, and software is supposed to do that for you. Now, if once I have factor of safety for a given condition and I analyze for different slip surfaces, what is the factor of safety, right? Then if I, let's say, I'm varying two or three variables to create that circles or you can say slip surfaces, with those variables as basis and the factor of safety as a variable, right? I have to find where I am getting the minimum factor of safety somehow. That is another optimization problem in some sense, right? So here in this example, what you see is you have this grid that you had in the last slide, and at each grid point, what is the minimum factor of safety? And that you plot and then plot contours. And then from that, you can find out where the minimum factor of safety is expected. Once you have that point, then you generate back the slip surface and know which slip surface gave you that minimum factor of safety in a way. So there is some lot of iterations that are going on to find one global minima of the factor of safety. Now, that is when I do comprehensive analysis for every combination possible. But many times it is not necessary that I'm interested in minimum factor safety. I may be interested in which has more damage in a way, right? So imagine I have a slope and I got minimum factor safety where actually the failure is happening only superficial on the surface. And that is going to only maybe move maximum 10 kgs or 20 kgs of soil. And that gave me the minimum factor of safety. That is not important. Even if that damage happens, I can repair it, not a problem. But there is a slightly higher factor of safety I'm getting for a mass, which is, let's say, 1,000 meter cube of mass is moving down from the slope, right? Now that is more important because it's going to damage the whole thing. So it's not about only finding the minimum factor safety. It is also important to know how much mass is going to move with it, right? So that's where I need to consider different scenarios within or nearby the minimum factor safety region where I can see how much mass is moving because of that. So those kind of analysis are also necessary in a way, right? With non-circular critical slip surfaces, I need to use which methods can account for it, like Janbu's method, right? With the certain limitations, we have to mark those points, they have become invariable, and other locations in the slip line become variable. And from that, I need to do some analysis, but method of analyzing is same. It's only the equation for factor of safety and assumptions behind it that change. Other than that, iterations and everything else is similar. There is no big difference as such, right? So the only thing I have to worry about is the method that I'm using, whether that is correct or not. Rest everything, all the analysis that we discussed so far is same, whether I have circular slip surface to be assumed or non-circular slip surface to be assumed, right? Okay. I think it takes time for changing the slide on the presentation. I don't know why. Okay. So maybe I can start explaining that what I mentioned is weak zones, and you can say with larger mass, soil moving. These are couple of scenarios where I have to bias my analysis, right? So if, let's say, large mass is moving, but I don't care if it is not affecting the building at the top, right? But if it is affecting the building also, its foundation is going to have secondary impact, and then I have to worry about it, even if that has factor of safety higher, right? So like that, so I have to identify what kind of situations will be more important to me against failure, right? And that's where I need to find sometimes factor of safety corresponding to that. And then accordingly, there are several solutions that I should look at, not one. Now, the last segment, which will take only 5-10 minutes, hopefully, I'll then stop. So landslides, I have talked about briefly. There are several, you can say, types of landslides that can happen based on the failure modes. There can be slides, falls, flows, creep, and I'll show you some of those one by one. So you can directly, rotational slides like this, where the whole mass has come down, right, like a failure in circular type slip surface, a huge mass movement, but soil is moving, slope is moving down. It's not really the, you can say, the, you can say, the, like similar to water kind of movement it looks like, but it is not. A debris flow is a different case altogether. Then you have rock fall and topples that happen. That is another challenge. In Konkan region that I was talking about, you have both scenarios. You have residual soils, lateritic soils, which are very, very susceptible to water absorption and lose strength because of that. But also there are rocks there, and once the rocks lose support, they just roll down and fall on the tracks. And that used to be the problem, right? And there are different solutions for these two scenarios in a way, right? One is drainage related, another is rock movement. So I have to capture that somehow, right? So this is one type. Then you have translational slides. Here on the right side, the example is shown in terms of almost like rocks kind of formation, but actually similar thing happens in soils as well. So you imagine you have 2-3 layers of soil, and the top soil 4-5 meter, let's say, is softer soil, and below that you have harder strata. Relatively, the top soil may creep down compared to the top, the bottom soil, and that may slide down. That will be translational type thing. But if it is just creeping, it's not failing in a way, then we call it slope creeps. And if you go to some of the sites, sloping grounds, sometimes you will see that trees are inclined. They're not vertical, right? So they can happen like purely inclined like this, or they can happen like this where it is even slower. So the creep is happening, but on the right side, what you see is creep is happening, but it has, it had enough time to go even then vertically in a way, something like that. But in the left side, if you see, what you see is that the whole tree has become inclined. And it is not to one or two trees. The consistently all the trees on that slope are inclined. What you see here on the left, also a, you can say, barbed wire kind of thing, pole of that, and that has also got inclined in a way, right? So why would that happen? Because the roots or the pole that is embedded deep enough, and the strata below is not moving as fast as the soil above. And because of that, it is kind of lateral sliding that is happening, relative sliding, and that is in tilting the tree or pole itself in a way. So if you see something like that, you know it's not a stable slope. It's a creeping active slope. It can fail anytime as well. It's a dangerous situation to have. Debris flow is another challenge. You can say, you may remember Kedarnath, right? A cloudburst happened, and then on the way, there were several small hills that collapsed into the water that was gushing through, and that created mud-like situation, and that whole thing came down to Kedarnath and it damaged the whole thing. So what you see on the right side, the overall picture, how the water came from two different channels, and with collapses of soil around, it kind of engulfed the whole Kedarnath area. Although fortunately, some of the, you can say, classical structures or old structures survived that, but it was a big mess and a lot of people died because of that, right? We could not do anything much of it anyway, but that was a good example of debris flow kind of damage on the area anyway. I think it is going too slow. Yeah, so with different types of landslides, you have different velocities, and you can say how much time I have to for reacting to that in a way. That also varies. So accordingly, the solutions may vary as well, right? Just for fun, I have shown here one picture I got from somewhere. I don't know, somebody was showing in some presentation somewhere. So I saw that, so I took it. That is from Mars. So these landslides don't happen only on the Earth, right? They happen other places as well, just to have fun. They can happen underwater also, right? Especially earthquake or tsunami kind of condition can cause that slope failure. But as slope failure can happen in, or landslide can happen in the mountains, there are, you can say, strata variations in the below the water, and that can also cause these kind of things. So when we are making offshore structures, we need to worry about that, right? I think I have already taken so much time. Probably I was ambitious to cover a lot of things, but I have summarized some of the reasons for cause of landslides, and many of those are similar to what happens in the slope. So I'm not going to repeat that, right? But you can say that they're more for natural soils, but reasons are similar. They are not very different, right? Then different mechanisms of landslides are also similar what you had for the slopes. Pore pressure buildup, residual shear strength, and all those issues that we discussed are applicable in a slightly different form, you can say, in a way. And as the shear strength is lost, you have those failures to happen. Or if seepage condition is changing, that is another, you can say, challenge in a way. In mountains, this seepage is the biggest challenge, I can assure you that, right? And I mean, sometimes it's very weird type of channels that form. Sometimes even 2-3 kilometers away, something happened, and that can cause problem for your hill far away from there, in a way. Because the rocks can carry water through cracks for long distance as well. So what are the effects of landslide? Of course, we know that it's dangerous and there are a lot of problems that happen. I just listed those. There is a map available where it people have, or we have mapped, you can say, where landslide happens more and where landslide happens less. And also there are certain localized zones that have been marked where we see landslides happening every year almost. Most of those are in Himalayan regions as well as in northeast areas in a way. So in a way, this landslide, satellite imagery can help in planning that, and instrumentation on the site, monitoring the slope movement can help in forecasting some of that information. When the slide is going to happen and so on, and we can get early warning system can be done. So there is a lot of effort, not only technically, but non-technical also, which we do have some systems in place, but not enough. So many times you would know that some road is blocked or not because of landslide, but sometimes people die also. So we have to improve on that further in a way. There are several, it's a huge problem. It's a huge mass that gets involved in these things, right? So at the same time, there are mitigation techniques that are available. And what I was mentioning that I think Madam Minimal had presented some case studies to earlier, hopefully. So I will show just a few of those variations to you, more those techniques, and stop at that, right? Some nice pictures that you can enjoy, right? So I can have some retaining structures. I can have those like gravity structures or cantilever walls made of gravity structures made of rock that you see here. And there can be cantilever retaining walls even placed there. I can rather more effectively use these, you can say, crib wall, which is more like a beam and columns attached to each other kind of thing. And that is stopping the soil to move down, supporting the soil in a way that you will see on the next slide. What you saw with the earlier presentation a couple of days back was probably gabion based solutions that we use as a either gravity wall, or sometimes even gabion has you can say trailing geogrid or extended wire mesh itself as a reinforcement in the soil. So that can also be done. Now these kind of things we have done here for ravine protection in IIT Gandhinagar campus as well, these kind of solutions. So somehow it has become very, very slow. So next slide, I'm on that for almost 1 minute, but it is still not showing that. Okay, hopefully, yeah. So on the left side, you see crib wall, which is becoming popular now because it's very cheap, relatively. And of course, gabion wall, which is even cheaper compared to those concrete walls, etc. Right? Other retaining structures like this, what you see, reinforced soil walls, kind of, you will see on the next slide, hopefully. They can be really, really tall and made in different stages to stabilize big hills. And even in India itself, there are so many hills that have been stabilized now. A lot of construction has been done. So fortunately, we have very good experience of using geosynthetic reinforced soil walls or slopes. So this is GRS kind of situation in a way on the right side. On the left side, you have more of a GRS wall type situation in a way, right? And I mean, we have done this in our country up to 60, 70 meter of stabilization at some places, even more. Then you have option of nailing or anchored walls. Now, these nailings can also be done with crib wall in combination of that. So you have concrete, you can say, beams and columns kind of thing, and at the center you put, at the junction you put nails kind of thing. So that is also possible wherever it is needed. So there are several such options available. Now, depending on what you like and what is cheaper, what is easier for you to construct, you have different choices. For rockfall protection, there is a passive way of doing that, you can say. So what happens is, instead of bolting each rock to make it stable, what we say is let it fail, but it should not affect my functioning in a way. So in the left side, you see there is a road at the bottom, and this whole thing is getting covered by a wire mesh and with nailing at some interval. So if rock falls at one location somewhere, rest of the mass will have this net keeping it at place, and that net will stop that rock from falling off to that road, so that people are saved at least, right? And after that, if you see that you want to remove that rock, you can go back and remove that rock. At least life-threatening situation will not come, right? Similarly, on the right side, what you see is near the river kind of thing, where you don't want big rocks falling down onto that in a way. And you have another method of doing that. So the rocks can be coming from way above the hill there on the left side of the right picture. And this net is independently supported by some mass at some interval. So if some rock comes, that will fall onto this net and it will dissipate its energy and reduce its velocity, and it will stop there in a way. So some flexibility of the net is helping you stop the rock from going to the downside. If I see some extra mass removal can help, of course I can do that. I can remove some soil from the top, and that probably will give some stabilization. As I said, biggest problem is not soil, biggest problem is always water, right? So we can also provide horizontal drains or some kind of drain network under the ground, subsurface drainage, so that I can have water drained out easily and the soil remains stable in a way. So like what you see on the right picture, water is coming out almost continuously from under the ground. So that way the water table goes down and your slope becomes stable. That's a very easy and very simple solution. This is for more of a debris flow condition on the next slide, where the erosion due to heavy rain water, if it is happening, you stop that silt water on the way, and siltation helps you, you can say, against further erosion in a way. I hope that slide comes, and I'm ending there almost. Just give me some more patience. Okay, it stopped moving completely, I think. Okay, I will stop there. I don't know why slide is not moving anymore. It's just stopped completely. Okay, there are some erosion control matrices that are available as well. That also you can use, and you can nicely put green grass on top of that. So I'll be happy to share with you this slides if you need. I hope. Okay, I will stop there.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your full session. Now, sir, there are a few questions from the participant sides. So, should I sir, share with you?
Yeah, please.
Okay.
And I want to apologize for this delay, actually. I didn't plan that it will go for 90 minutes.
No, sir, not at all. It is not a fault of us. It's a technical error. What else can we do that? Okay, so the question is, in case of engineering landfill, the material differs from the soil. So can we use the same methods of slope stability for landfills also?
So, method of analysis is not going to be very different in a way, but what happens is in landfills, the material properties that you use for, you can say, estimation, that is what the problem is, right? And with biodegradation happening, how do you assess the properties? That is the challenge. So estimation of properties is the challenge. It's not really the method of analysis, I would say. Right. So one small point that I can make is when you dump a new fresh waste site versus after 10 years, its properties are going to be very different, very, very different. And in the beginning, when you are estimating, you cannot do this regular triaxial test and estimate the properties. You have to use 300 mm diameter large triaxial kind of system to estimate the properties. So many times what we end up with is some assumed value of the strength. That's all, based on some plate load test or something on top, and you back calibrate the value. Does that answer your question?
Piyush Kataria, is it okay? Or you need more clarification?
Sir, actually the main thing what we have cleared that it's all about properties of the right. So my question is actually related to that method is okay that we can use the same method, but the properties are going to be changed in years also, and at the same time it will change as per the what type of waste is there. It most of the time it will be the mixture of the waste. Right. We cannot say it is the properties are very defined in a way. It cannot be defined. So what we have to do in that case?
So that is what I meant is you have to do large direct shear or large triaxial kind of test, and those are generally not available. So if you are doing landfills type material or construction waste or slag or all these heterogeneous with large particle variations. Particle size variation, right?
Yes.
So these things, either there are two options. One is you can remove the large particles and take the small particles contribution in that and test that in the small lab, right? Second is that even that is not possible because you may have plastic and all those things mixed up, all everything. Then you core the sample out and you do the large scale test itself on the sample. Okay. Then also you have to do if you want to do analysis for long term also, then you have to somehow estimate the properties after long term when biodegradation has happened. Yes. But then the properties will be totally different altogether. Okay. So that area itself is a big issue. And I don't know if enough work has been done in that area.
Yes, that's why I'm asking.
So it's a research topic. I think if you are interested, you should do some research in this.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Thank you for the suggestion, sir. Thank you so much.
Sure.
So another question is, which method should be adopted for slope stability analysis in softwares like FEM modeling or LE modeling, as the Plexus launched recently? So Plexus LE, which based on limit equilibrium?
So limit equilibrium methods are not based on FEM, and FEM is used for deformation based analysis, right? So for any of these slope stability based codes or codes for slope stability are going to help you with only limit equilibrium method in a way. Within limit equilibrium method, you have several methods available, and depending on which you like or which conditions, and some actually some there is some understanding on which case which method works better also. You can actually refer to a book by Abramson and Lee, and that gives you some comparisons of these different methods as well. So in a way, limit equilibrium method is in practice even today. But if you want to do performance-based design, if you want to do find out how my structure at the top is going to be affected, what will happen if the earthquake happens, all those things, right? Secondary effects. So then you need FEM analysis. That you want to estimate how much settlement will happen in the foundation above. You want to estimate how the deformation is going to happen at the toe, in a way, for certain other aspects that you have there, kind of thing. So those are performance-based design. Now, those have not come in practice yet, right? So those FEM-based analysis are still confined to mostly, the research purpose, mainly. But in practice, I'm yet to see where people will use FEM for slope stability analysis.
Okay. So another question is, which type of a material use in black cotton soil for slope stability?
So when you have black cotton soil, you will have that as a foundation soil. You don't want to use black cotton soil for embankment, right? So, and fortunately, most of the black cotton soils, wherever you have, you will have it as flat, not very hilly type, most of the cases, right? So what your question is, if I have to make an embankment or something on top of the black cotton soil, what should I do, right? You should worry about differential swelling, and that means you need to provide enough load at the top everywhere so that it doesn't affect your embankment, or you have to provide some kind of reinforcement in between, or replacement of the just enough replacement. I'm not saying replace the whole black cotton soil, right? So these are some of the methods. So I said three things. One is, if you have continuously enough load on top which can counter the soil pressure, you don't need to worry about it. Second is, you can provide basal mattress or similar kind of things which can take care of the differential pressure coming from the bottom, right? Third thing, I excavate 1 meter of black cotton soil and fill it with sand or something non-swelling, right? So that at least some soil pressure will be reduced at the ground level. Those kind of things we can do. Make sense?
Okay. Now, anyone from the participants want to ask anything, any question? They can unmute their mic and ask. Okay, thank you, sir, for your insightful sessions. And it's been great pleasure that you have accepted our invitation from on the behalf of Applied Mechanics Department and LD College of Engineering. We are very much thankful to you. Thank you, sir, for your insightful session and disseminate your knowledge among ourselves. Thank you, sir.
Sure. My pleasure. Thank you all for your patience and listening to the talk. Okay. All the best.